So I was just telling John that today what we really want to do is just talk about acting, and hear from like John and kind of his opinions and ideas and the journey. And as I told a lot of you guys, John trained me and trained Marty, and we just like owe him so much for the way he's taught us and what he helped, the way he helped us see acting from a different point of view. So first I want to ask you, John, like, how did you get into it? Like, how did you find out that this was what you wanted to do?
By accident, in my case,
Yep.
Because I came from the idea of being an actor was so alien to anything that I could have thought of. I was just this country kid from South Australia, you know. I didn't know anything about acting, but you know, we used to go to the matinees and watch pictures of American people, you know, who rode horses and were very handsome or beautiful. That was all I knew about acting, and I finally got sent down to Adelaide to boarding school, and then I went to university there, and I still didn't know anything about it. Apparently I used to clown around a lot, they tell me, at boarding school, and I used to do imitations of people, but I wasn't sort of conscious of that. And then I was doing an elective at one stage, by the stage I was in my early 20s, and it was drama, and I was drawn to it for some unknown reason. Perhaps there was a good-looking chick. I can't remember what it was.
It's a pretty good reason.
Anyway, to cut a long story short, the teachers in that thing kind of said, "Who is this fella?" And I think mainly it was my voice that got them. And they said, "Will you come and do some community theatre?" Now, at that stage in Adelaide, there was no professional theatre. In fact, in Australia, there was virtually no professional theatre. But community theatre was astonishing, so bloody exciting. And I went into that anyway, and to answer your question, I found for the first time in my life something that I knew I was really good at and that I loved so much. And that's true. That's what happened to me. It was like the lights went on. And all the other things I'd done and the studies I'd done for law and accountancy and all those sort of normal things that a man does when you come from there, whap out the window. And and I was so lucky because I hit there was a period of time in Australia where a whole generation, our generation, the baby boomers, you know, were just starting to find our voice, and we were starting to say, why the hell don't we have a culture? Why are we all sitting around doing English plays and American plays? And so there's this sort of angry intellectual undercurrent went came through and created all of these theatre companies and so forth, and also the film industry just started to boom at that stage. I was in the theatre side of it, not the film side of it, and that created this enormous upsurge, and I was so lucky to be part of that and got swept. And I was working in the first wave of professionals. What I had to do very quickly, I realised that I needed to get voice trained. I knew that, and I found a fantastic ex-RADA or a RADA woman who lived in Adelaide, brilliant, God, I loved her, and she taught the voice, she taught it really well, and that was a huge advantage for me. And then I was, it's more like the old British system where you kind of learned on the job in theatre. You'd go in there and you would, like an apprenticeship in a sense, and thrown in at the deep end, always, just thrown, I was always thrown in at the deep end. I loved it. I still love it.
Why'd you love it?
Oh, my, dangerous. I love it. So I love television. It's so dangerous. There's no direction, nothing. There's no time. It's going to work off your first instincts. Yes, boom, and you go, risk it. No one tells you not to. And I adore that. I still don't like being told what to do, I think. I don't know. I didn't say that. I think I would have been a horror to direct when I was young though, because I was just booming through it. And in those days I used to get bored with rehearsals because I got a really quick memory, and I'd say, gotcha, you know, and I'd be ready to go after 2 days and everyone else is still sitting there for 3 weeks. Mind you, I don't do that anymore, but that was just the way I was then. But that's how I got into it, and it was a really lucky thing. And then then I actually finished up being artistic director of a theatre company for a long time, and I fell more into directing then,
right?
Which I didn't really like very much.
Why didn't you like it?
I didn't like it. I don't know, because I liked acting. Right. I did it, and I did it really successfully, but it wasn't a passion for me. It wasn't a passion. And so when I finally decided that I wanted to come and do theatre and film and television, sorry, by this stage I'm 40. Most people are thinking hanging up their boots, but not me. I'm about to start off.
So you started off at 40, basically?
Film and television.
Right, film and television.
Yeah.
Anyone here that I've heard, like, I'm too old?
Well, I mean, I'd
you're not.
Let me correct you. What I'd done in Adelaide in that time, the South Australian Film Corporation was there. I was running a theatre company, but they were making at that stage enormous numbers of documentaries and training films, and they'd always ask me to do them.
Right.
So whilst I don't consider it to be part of a film, I learnt so bloody much doing those, like dozens of them. And I've got a lot of the directors were mates of mine. And so I guess I learnt a lot.
Yeah.
In a fairly safe environment, to be honest with you. So I became by the time I actually decided to go into film and television, I was already really proficient technically in it. I'd forgotten about that. From doing them, from acting in them, because it was a kind of a safe way for me anyway. I'm very observant. I'm always watching what's happening to learn the technique. And I went bang. I was snapping it up as it went, in a safer environment. and a lot of them. I mean a lot. God knows how many there were.
Are they still around?
Oh, I would never clue.
John Noble training video from like.
I'm just trying to think who it was. Damon Herriman. Do you know Damon?
You know Damon. Yeah. Damon was in one with you, Hal.
Damon Herriman's an actor in LA, and Damon was a little boy, about this big, and I played his dad. And he still remembers it. He loves it.
Can I ask him? I'm about to work with him. I'm going to ask him.
Yeah, tell him about it. No, he'll tell you.
Be great.
Yeah. I can't remember what it was about now.
I want to go
probably
back.
About some poison or something, yeah, or other, yeah. You know, or the dangers of trucking companies or something or other. God knows what it was, herpes or something. I don't know if I did one about herpes. I don't think I would have wanted to. Wouldn't do a lot for your reputation, would it? When you're a young bloke around town.
Doing herpes.
Sorry.
I want to go back. When you said you found out you loved it,
yeah.
What did you do at that moment? Because you'd already committed to something else, right? How did you make the move when you went, okay, I love this?
Well, I was fortunate. As I said, the opportunities were being afforded to me.
Right.
Because of certain qualities I had, people kept asking me to do things. So had I not had that, and the same passions I've still got, absolutely still have it for acting.
Good.
It's never gone away. I still adore it. That made it kind of easy for me to direct people sometimes. There are terms used now like the power of intention and all sorts of loose terms used around the place, like pop terms, as if get an intention, you get it tomorrow morning. It doesn't actually work that way. But I think by having some sort of I don't know, it's almost like there is almost a subconscious focus of where you want to go. So the other voices you hear, they're the signs you see ahead of you, they're the doors that you see opening ahead of you. So I guess you take opportunities. And the times when I've actually taken the wrong choice for pragmatic reasons, let's make say, hey, done something because I thought this is a responsible thing to do because, you know, I really should go and get a proper job and this company's offering me a lot of money to do this over here. Hated it every time. It was a disaster. Seriously, I mean, big disasters. Shockers. But I mean, it was, instead of just trusting that I knew I didn't want to do it, and I was being so grown up and responsible, disastrous. So, no, I just listening to whatever those voices. I can understand them now, but I'm trying to put it into context of what I felt at the time. I do understand them now. I had this bloody vision, and this is bizarre, and I've never confessed this until 5 years ago. But when I was a young fella in that burgeoning industry, I had no right to think this, but I set myself 3 goals. I still have to almost whisper it. And I was working in this professional, but alternative professional theatre. And I said, I want to, to myself, I want to direct on the West End of London. Oh, how ridiculous is that? You cannot imagine how ridiculous that is. At this stage, I hadn't even started directing. I want to act in a great motion picture. Oh, you've got to be kidding, you know. Yeah, right. You know, you play in the 100-seat theatre in Adelaide. Yeah. And I want to act on Broadway. Well, that actually happened. How the hell does that happen? But something, there was something, and I've never forgotten feeling it, almost being embarrassed about it, and thinking, a bloke from Port Pirie's got no right to think these things. God almighty. I never even met an actor before 3 weeks ago. But it was weird, and it happened. So I don't know. It's hard to know, isn't it, what that intention is and what power it has. And I, as I said, I was embarrassed. I hadn't even told my wife until 5 years ago. I finally confessed. I was a little bit red in the face thinking about it.
Why does it make you red in the face?
Because it's such a bold thing to think. And we're Australians, mate. You don't go crowing about things. You've got to be infinitely humble if you're Australian.
So, but as you were going through your career, were they kind of sitting in your subconscious? Like you always knew you'd set this for yourself?
And of course, but of course. But this, it wasn't sticking out there like DBs, you know. It was obviously something. I was talking about the doors you choose. And there were certain doors I chose were never going to lead me there. They might have made me really responsible and all sorts of things, but they're never going to take me down that path. So I destroyed all of those.
Was it hard to destroy them? Like when you're thinking, I'm making money, I
did inappropriately.
You just go, fuck it, I'm going to kick the door down and...
Quite inappropriately. I'm not proud of that, but it happened. Enough of that. But enough of those stories. No more of those stories. Ask me another question.
So then as you were kind of going through, what was kind of the first gig that you kind of got that you were just kind of like... It's challenging me, I'm kind of growing, or did every gig you get as you were going through this, you just found what to learn from every single gig you did?
I was lucky that I never got really offered shitty roles.
Right, okay.
I think it was something to do with my stature, my voice, that I was always kind of offered really substantial roles. And I was quite often offered roles of people that were older than myself, so quite substantial characters. And so no, I don't remember doing too many roles that I wasn't challenged by. Yeah, we're going back a bit now. We're not talking about the last 15 years of film and television. And I mean, to some extent, because I ran the company, I had a bit of say in which ones I took as well in the latter days. But I mean, some of my favourite memories were non-professional, seriously. Just wonderful stuff.
Do you have any that you can recall?
I still remember it so vividly. Hmm?
Do you have any that you can recall?
Well, we did a Marat Sade once, which was stunning. We did a couple of Jean Genet plays that were amazing, just amazing productions. I was acting in them, not directing them. I can still remember them so vividly as some of the best stuff I've ever seen or been in. But that was before professional. So the people that were in it were all really good and terribly creative. I remember those two in particular.
Yeah.
So then, but to move on, I guess, into the more, what we deal with, don't we, is film and television primarily now. Is that a fair comment for us sitting here? So having kind of worked through that, and that became an incredible training ground for me. And the one thing I want to say about the stage years is that it provided me with an incredible set of skills. And I'd already mentioned that I'd studied very carefully while I was doing this other stuff technically. So technically, I did know a lot about film and television before I actually started to do it. In fact, I knew enough to teach about it. That was where I'd got to with it. But theatre was what provided me with a whole range of skills. For example, improvisation. People think it's something you just do at drama school and forget about. Oh no, every day of your life, every day, you improvise. That's wonderful. And to have the courage to do that. Look, let's talk television. Nobody tells you what to do. They just don't. You know, you basically, at best, you'll go on there, you get a script maybe a day or so before. You go and do a line read. Huh? There's a line read, real quick line read. And then they'll say, okay, all right, yeah. all right, well, I just want to block it now. So they block the camera really quickly. Okay, bring the boys in. They bring the crew in. This is what we're doing. Mark it all up. See you later, they say to us. And we go away. Well, they light it. Then we come back and shoot it. Yes?
Yes.
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 That's it. We come back and shoot it. So you don't get anyone pandering to you. You don't get any directors sitting down in the corners with you and giving you guidance or any of this type of thing, or giving you a long time to work it out. That can be a terrible shock, but I love it. Because it means once you get used to it, it means that what I do is make an awful lot of quick decisions, first instinct decisions. And sometimes they're really risky. Because I haven't got time to edit them and I don't want to edit them. I'll get an instinct on how to do a line or a mannerism to play or something. And I'll do it. Now what that provides though, what that provides is that sense of danger and that we see when actors work sometimes. Like, where the hell did that come from? That's so unusual instead of being tried and true performance. And that's what keeps us really interested in people, isn't it? When it's kind of dangerous and risky and edgy and unusual, just like people are. Because we are not banal. We don't sort of sit around being very ordinary. I hope we don't. And we're awfully funny. Do you know that? People are incredibly funny. And we're not when we try to be funny. We usually die on our asses when we try to be funny. But people are so funny. People talk to me about me doing comedy. I said, I never try to do comedy, mate. I just look at people. I just play people, respond as people respond to situations. And if it's funny, well, that's because people are funny. I mean, obviously, you learn a little bit about timing as you go by, about how to drop certain things in. But so the whole drama and the whole comedy exists within us, within the way we interact with each other. We don't have to go and invent it or invent a methodology to do it. We have to find the great acting thing called truth. You know, there you go, bingo, up in lights. Find the truth and be just bold enough to do it instead of being scared to do it because you think it's too ridiculous. Because human beings are so ridiculous. We are so funny. I mean, seriously, I'm a watcher of people and I sort of sit in places and watch people absolutely fascinated. And I tune into their conversations. I could have this ability to tune into a conversation the other side of the room. So if you concentrate hard enough, you can hear what they're saying. My wife hates it. I don't do it so much anymore, but I used to, and I'd be mesmerised. And she'd think I was perving on this woman over there, and I wasn't, always. John, are you here with me? What? Yeah. Watching people. Watching their mannerisms, yes.
Do you have a question then?
I had a question when you were talking back about making quick choices and using your instincts.
Mm.
Is that when you're first reading a script, or is that on set you're discovering that when you're actually doing it?
Okay, good question. Look, I think film's a very different proposition than television, but let's talk about television. We don't spend as much time studying scripts as people think we do, okay? If you're doing a television series, you will read an episode when it comes out, which you might get a few days beforehand. But you're still shooting the other one, so you sort of read it. And generally won't go back to that scene, per se, until the night before. Sometimes the same day, okay? And, you know, you become very, very, very fast at processing stuff. And you have many actors will still be there, even at the read-through. They'll have the sides in their hand and they're still memorising as they go. Now, that sounds like they're bad actors. They're not. They're really good actors. They actually know how to do this very well. Particularly if you get someone who's got a massive load to do. I was just working with an actor called Johnny Lee Miller, who was playing Sherlock. And he would have, huge slabs of stuff every day, and come to the read through, he would still be on his sides, and even in the camera rehearsal, he'd be on his sides. But then once it was there, it was there. But with the load he had to carry, that was the way he processed it. But it was still amazing, because his character was so processed, and he had such possession of that character that he couldn't do it wrong. The performance was mesmerizing to watch, you know? But he just sometimes the actual, and he'd have the thoughts right, but sometimes the words weren't quite coming in the right place, which brings me to an important part. It's not so much about words, it's about thoughts. It's always about thoughts. Everything's about thoughts. And so you don't try to, I don't try to learn words. Oh my God, that must be terrible. I followed through a series of, no, seriously, it must be so hard. It's the wrong side of the brain doing that, but, you know, it's not my creative side. But I learned the thoughts and the logical thoughts and what, you know, things like, well, what the hell's this scene in here for? You know, why is this scene? Because it's got a reason to be there. So there's obviously someone wants it to go somewhere to achieve something in there. And so you find your own little passage through it. And it's all linked by thoughts. And so you find out what those links are. You think them through. And then that'll be interrupted. And the thought will be added to or enhanced by someone else's thought. And so this little map comes into your head, the thoughts. There you go. You can do that really quickly. Then you pop the words in afterwards. Am I making sense? Yeah, sort of. Yeah. This is critical stuff. Absolutely critical. I've worked with actors who still work on the line basis. It's agonising for me to watch them. No, seriously, these are good professional actors. Agonising for me to watch them. It's, oh, geez. The stress that it puts them under. It's not funny for them. I mean, seriously, oh my God, I wonder why they do it. I wonder why they do it. Well, you could do it as a mind map, but your mind will do it for you. Your mind will do it for you. It's the same as we in our lives. Just we link things, albeit strangely, we link our thoughts, we link our processes, we link our day through a series of thoughts, and sometimes they go off in tangents. And sometimes they'll be interrupted by something else. You can actually do, if you wanted to, you can do mind maps of it, and you can do mnemonic exercises for it, and you can do memory tricks, and I've done those in the past, and I've taught those. But trust me when I tell you that you do this automatically every day when you're talking. Otherwise, you really wouldn't be able to hold a conversation, would you? You think about it. You wouldn't be able to hold a conversation because you'd have one sentence and that would be it. But it's not. It sort of links into something else and leads somewhere else. And there's a tangent coming in here, and then you'll think of something else will come in. But it's all sort of linked. And that's what we have to do as actors. And that's when it looks so... I often get asked the question, come on, how much do you guys ad-lib? None. Nothing. Nada. Never. Not in television, you can't. But it looks like it. Isn't that great? It looks like we're making it up. That's a huge compliment to us. Because in television... certainly in network television, you can't make up a thing. It's been through so many filters by the time it gets to us that if I wanted to change a little phrase, the script supervisor would have to get on the phone to Los Angeles and get approval from the head writer. So,
Adam.
So just to go back to that question a second ago, so looking at a script, you get a script, you don't look at the words, you look at the thoughts. So what would you then go step by step, how would you then learn those thoughts?
Okay. Well, the words give me the thoughts. I do read the words, of course, but and sometimes I even read the big black print that tells you what you're supposed to be doing on it, but not always. He pales visibly. I remember that one once.
Like, he pales
visibly.
Pale.
What pales visibly? Oh, Jesus. Or they'll tell you when to cry and all that sort of stuff. No. Sometimes they're important, though. Sometimes they're important. The linking of the thoughts, yeah. No scene ever... All right, okay, I've got to stand.
Let me help you.
Limited by my...
There you go.
I do this a lot, get in trouble. When I'm up on stage now. Panels, and they want you to sit very nicely up the front so they can film you and all that, and I jump around the place. Go down to the audience, they're trying to find you down there with torches. Oh, I think better on my feet. No scene states it starts in isolation, huh? Nothing starts in isolation. It's a continuation of a piece of life. And the reason that we see it is because it's considered by the writers to be an important piece of life. That's all. I mean, the scene that we may shoot today may start in 1 minute. It doesn't mean to say we haven't had all this stuff beforehand, you understand what I mean? So every scene opens with an energy that it brings in with it. Brings in an energy. Now, there's a terrible temptation to start a scene as if it's the beginning of the world. Huh? It's not. We bring things into it. And that energizes stuff. And we take stuff out the other end. It doesn't all drift away into a soft focus. Oh, my God. Like we're watching Days of Our Lives, because Days of Our Lives does that really cleverly. It's a really interesting technique. But no, we don't. So what? It's just a grab of something. So we take the stuff. What are you bringing in? Basic acting stuff. What are you bringing with you? What are you bringing in with you? Sure, you have to do that. You have to do that. Otherwise, unless you do that, you've got no concept of what the relationship is. You've got no concept of how you feel about the other person. You've got no concept of what may have prompted this situation. I believe in getting as much information as the character has, nothing more.
Right. Okay.
Very important point, that one. Some people think, oh, well, I have to know the full story. It's like in stage work, you know, how we sit down and we read the whole thing and we read it. In truth, all my character needs to know is what my character knows. And I really don't want to know any more than that. So even though you're sort of outside my little cocoon, the world may be imploding somewhere or other, and if my character doesn't know it, then I can't play it. I don't want to know it. And I don't want to be reacting as if that's the case, because that leads to very bad acting. And it leads to telegraphing, and it leads to all of those bad things that we've heard about so many times. Play the truth that your character knows. I mean, I may not know something about the character that I'm playing with. You know, I may be playing a scene with you, and I don't know that you've just found out a terrible thing about yourself and you're going through desperate because someone in your family's died. I don't know that, so I'm still treating you like my friend instead of playing that empathy. Right? I don't want to do that. But it's very tempting, unless you actually think about it, to play, because you're playing so sad and I do care about you. But I don't know that, so I don't play it. So bringing that in with you helps an awful lot. And then you just take that energy with you. Take it through with you. And don't let people sit on stuff. How often in life do we sit down and take great pauses, honestly? How often? No, not much. We don't, do we? But yet there's this tendency for actors to want to hold moments and deliver moments as if they're gold. This applies, by the way, very much to the audition process as well, which is what we're going to talk about. It's not that important. We don't take great pauses. We do overlap each other a lot, which is a technical thing to work on film or television. But in the rehearsal period, overlap if you want to, until they tell you not to. Usually you have to do a clean take somewhere. You know, the sound mixer will say, can we do a clean here somewhere, just so they can use it. But it's make it as real as possible, as conversational as possible. And the thoughts will follow logically if you do that. And if you're listening to the other person, if your character's interested in the other person, now that's another point too. So if I'm in a situation and you can be talking over here, you're talking over there, and you might even be talking to me, but I'm worried about what he's thinking over there. Now, do I have to listen intently to you? No. Even though we say in acting, you've got to listen. Everything must listen, listen, listen. I don't want to listen to you. So whilst a part of me will be conscious of what you're saying, my whole intention is here. There's a difference instead of this. Because we get led down certain garden paths as actors, don't we, about listening, acting, it's listening and all that sort of, well, it is to something. But you don't only listen with your ears, you listen with every organ of your body, you know? When we're conversing with someone, we don't just listen to what they're saying, we're watching them. You can almost watch their breathing, you can tell by the colour of their face, you can look in their eyes and you can learn more about them than listening to what they're saying. You see what they're doing with their hands and mannerisms. This is how we listen to all these things. This is much more interesting than listening to the words.
So are you saying that we should know the thing and just look at it simplistically as a whole?
I didn't understand that question. We should know the thing? What do you mean?
Right, like, so in regards to reacting, you should treat it as like one basic objective each time, in a way.
As what objective, sir?
So the objective being like, okay, I'm listening to this person now, they are my friend.
No, I didn't say that at all. No, no, not at all. I said treat them as if, as your character knows them, that's all.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
They may not be your friend at all. They may be complete strangers. You know, some of the technical things we talk about in acting about status and all these things are important, but you don't, the actor knows them, but your character doesn't know that. Your character will play status if he feels he's got status. You know what I'm talking about, his status. You play it if you think you've got it. And sometimes you get your knees cut off by someone who'll take your status away from you. And we know that technically as actors, but your character doesn't know it. Okay? Character can't be thinking about technique. You, the actor, must have it intrinsic and instilled in you so deeply that you don't think about it. Okay? Don't go and play in technique. It's too evident, yeah.
Do you think there are times where, like in your scene, you as the actor will know more than the character?
No.
But then you use that as you're playing the character, as the scene evolves, so you're like revealing things to help the story.
Yeah. It's called exposition. It's pretty ugly stuff. You know, we have to play exposition sometimes. Probably a better explanation of exposition is when we, the characters, are sort of sitting down and say, do you remember, chum, 3 weeks ago when you and I were talking about so-and-so and the phone rang and we go, oh, you got to be kidding. There's exposition for the sake of the audience and we have to do this. But we find interesting ways of doing it. But no, I don't think you can. You can't take away from the fact that you, the actor, know things that your character doesn't. What you can do is make sure your character doesn't evidently show that he or she knows those things or play them, because that's telegraphing, preempting, whatever you want to call it, and it's bad acting. Don't do it. Just don't do it.
Sarah's got a question.
Yes, Sarah.
What's your great way of finding like characters and being like different to obviously how, like I guess that's how people get the role from auditions is actually playing with characters and knowing what the character is and having your own little taste and flavour.
Mm.
Like, how do you find, like, do you research a lot to see what sort of character you feel is like that character that's on the script, or do you just sort of play with it as you're going, or?
Mm. Yes, 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 and yes. Yes, yes to everything.
Yeah.
Whatever the person is and whatever their expertise and whatever their skill base is, I'll be within a minute, right? They're still human beings. Fundamentally, they're human beings. So they'll have all of the mannerisms and the breathing, smelling, stinking, whatever we are, people. They'll have all those things. In terms of playing, I play very complex characters usually. That's what I love to do. And I do actually research those. Yeah, I do. I have to do justice to the complex characters, because I, John Noble, don't know all the things that this character would be required to know. I don't know quantum physics necessarily, you know. I don't know the Walter the Carlyle group of those financial people that live above us. I can find out, and I do find out. By hell, I find out. I really do find out before I go in there. I don't know what effect certain drugs will have on people necessarily, but I will certainly find out so that I can play them when I need to play them. Absolutely, absolutely find that out. Go on.
Sorry, just do you find, like, when you research, like, obviously research, but do you actually do where you try to, I know, like, went to another talk where a writer actually interviewed people that had, like, you know, that sort of characterization, or was that from that particular group? Like, is that what you do as well? Like, say, for example, if you want to play scientist with creamy stuff, do you try to perhaps go around so you sort of observe what their mannerisms are like?
Yes, 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 and yes. Yes, okay, good question. So, I played a character called Walter Bishop for a long time, who was a very, very, very eccentric, crazy scientist fellow. I did actually go to university with a bloke who's still one of my friends, who is exactly like that. Seriously. He's crazy. He's still crazy. So that was sort of fun for me to do that. But I had to. That's a case in point. I mean, I had to research several things. One, I knew enough about things to know that this was all based on the 1980s Harvard experiments. All right, I knew this, where those group of Harvard professors were experimenting with LSD and with magic mushrooms and creating this whole thing. The CIA was involved funding it. I knew this, but I needed to go back and research to find out what was going on there. And it was also a period of certain types of music that was all impinging on it. It was a crazy period. But I went back and read it. And there's stuff around. I wanted to find out, the character I played had certain mannerisms which were described by the writers. And I thought, what the hell drugs would cause that to happen as a withdrawal? As a withdrawal, not to be played forever for 5 years, but for a period of time, and how long will that withdrawal last? So you go back in, you say, all right, what would cause that? You go, gotcha. And then you know what the withdrawal period is. And you know if it'll have any other effects. It's pretty simple, really, but it's really exciting because you feel so sure when you're doing it, you don't feel like a dickhead. You know, you really do. I found out what it was like, for example. I used to wonder, I love reading books by very, very smart people. I mean, I'm fascinated by that tiny percentage of people up here that are so smart that they can't communicate with us. Benny Hanley.
Hello.
Mate. Oh, my dear old friend. Hello, mate. How are you, love?
Hey, mate.
Oh, gee. That's deja vu. I haven't seen you for years. Oh, my Lord. So, I was talking about...
smart people up in the world.
So you find out, and you start to read. You start to read and find out what... And then you'll find out they have certain social behaviours. For example, that they are really... sometimes quite incapable of holding a normal conversation with people. That they find it really hard to hold a normal relationship in life with people. Not that they're bad people, they just can't do it. They're like they're talking two completely different languages. And the mundane things that may occupy us, no, they don't. None of them did. They don't. The only company they find interesting is their own and other people of their level. That's it, right? So you put this stuff, and then you go, you're clicking, you're going boom, ba, boom, ba, boom, that and several other things. You look, for example, at what the physical, what would happen physically to a character, that character again, if this man had been beaten down and beaten down and beaten down for so long and left as he was left. What is he going to be like physically? Is he going to be like me or is he going to be like this? Choice is that. Because if you ever watched that show, I played the opposite side of him too, and the stature of the other character was this. There were two versions of it. Just about all I did was change that to define those two characters. But it's based on how would a person respond to those circumstances. You see how rich it becomes and how sure you feel by the time you do this stuff. That your body, your mind, every part of you is involved in it. You are next, sir. Yes.
Oh, now? Okay. Sorry, I thought you were still saying something.
Oh.
Okay. Can you offer any tips in regards to rehearsals? I have a problem where I'm not sure whether or not I need, like, a certain scene needs a Michael Fassbender in media-style performance or something along the lines of Nicolas Cage in Vampire Kiss. How do you judge when to bring it out and when to
What are you talking about? Film, television, stage? What are you talking about?
I don't know.
Are you talking about?
Just talking about
bombing. No. That's a serious question. It's a serious question because occasionally you are asked to play within a style.
Okay.
Not very often. I would always err on the side of pace, by the way, rather than holding stuff back, always, of picking stuff up, just as a general principle. Lingering back and playing long stuff, I think, is really self-indulgent. Mm-hmm. Let's not do that.
Okay.
Sometimes you will get the opportunity to, not in television, but you know, and sometimes in film, they'll take the final shot and they'll just hold. They'll come in for that shot there, and it's beautiful. They'll just come in for that extreme close. That's fine. and the thought process will be happening. But it doesn't happen in television. They don't have time. So you've got to make it all happen before, you know. You don't want to drag out anything there. In life, we do have thought moments, and sometimes we will play those. And we do have listening moments. And while I say we rush everything, we do. But we can process so much so fast that what feels like it's going to take 15 seconds to think through probably only takes one, in truth. And we can get those processes going so fast. And you need to get the processes going. Don't get me wrong. You must think the thoughts. You have to think the thoughts. You can't make out you're thinking the thoughts. Because if you don't think the thoughts, it'll show in your eyes. And if it shows in your eyes, the audience know. They don't know what they know. They just know it's not very good.
So then it's more of a question of trusting yourself.
Well, you're talking style. Sometimes, if there is a style involved, if there is a rehearsal too, they will tell you what the style is, you know. So if you're playing a farce or something, well, you will know anyway, and there'll be a certain ba-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-ba-da goes on with it, and a lot of silliness. Most of the time, we're not given a style. We might be given even a genre doesn't make sense, because all genres are basically played the same except in different costumes, you know. I think you're making a hard job for yourself. Go in there and play intently, play intently, concentratedly, truthfully, directly. Don't be distracted by other stuff. Go in and play your stuff and let the rest of them look after that. That way you'll be good. They can always adjust you. But if you go and double guessing yourself, you won't be acting well. You simply won't be acting well. So just go in and do it. Yes. Thanks. Yes.
Before you were saying you were going through the deep end.
Yeah. No, that's a good question. I don't personally have the fear factor, not in that. I mean, as a human being living through life, of course, I have the fear factor, you know. But I guess I learnt very early that it was better to dive in.
That you learnt that early?
Very early. No, but I don't remember not having it. And it might have been something to do with earlier training I had, you know, in the law and so forth, where you actually have to be confident in whatever you're doing. And I had learned public speaking, and a lot of things that may have added up to that you can bluff pretty well. But I just found it was much better to risk something than that fear. I know what you're talking about. I've seen it. I've seen it cripple us. I've seen it cripple actors, and I've seen it cripple really good actors who then go through that period. I've had the sad experience of seeing a couple of times where actors may have been off for a while, maybe had some years off, and they were people with good reputations, and they come back in again, and oh God, it's horrible to watch. And then the fear starts to come in. I'll get to you, mate. The fear starts to come in, and once the fear enters, then everything else goes out. This is what happens, though. As soon as you let that tension into your body, no wonder you forget your lines, as they say. How the hell can you hold on to a thought process when you're in a state of tension? You can't. You literally can't, you know, because what happens to us human beings is we go into fight and flight. And if you want to look at the brain mechanisms of that, it's no time to be thinking about acting. So is this an issue you want to face, you deal with? And what? How does it manifest for you?
It's not so much, I think, forgetting lines, or it's more to do with choices. I find it difficult to be impulsive and make those choices that you say you like going in and being thrown in the deep end and being in the moment. And it's so freeing and fun.
Then it's got to come out of workshops, love. It's got to come out of workshops. And it's got to come out of classes where you make the choice to do that, to take the risk. You know, the greatest fear we have in life is to make a fool of ourselves. You know that, don't you? It's our greatest fear. We're so frightened of it. And then add on top of that things like being judged and being criticised and all those things. Well, God, as actors, hello, that's us. But the point is, by overcoming those things, we actually aren't. We don't make a fool of ourselves. And we usually don't get criticised either, because what we do is thrilling. But for you, it's somehow finding yourself in an environment, a safe enough environment. We talk about this, don't we? A safe enough environment where you can actually go for stuff without feeling that someone's going to laugh at you or snipe about you behind your back. The pricks and people do it, and I hate them for doing it. I hate them for doing that. Go out and take your risks, love. Go and take them. Find a group of people to work with and trust each other and go for it. You got it? Do it. And just feel this thrill of being in a safe place. Take risks you wouldn't dream of. And then your heart swells and you go, yes, I can do this thing. But not in places where there's competition, not in places where there's criticism and bitchiness, bad places to be. Don't go there. You got me on a very important point for me, that one. Yes.
Looking at like all the research and yep. things before and the mannerisms you find and things like that. How do you then like embody that for you with truth without playing a character?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, I just do embody it.
I think it's
well, I guess, okay, it's a very good question. I mean, it's easy to see the physicality I mentioned to you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it's quite easy to look at the vocal aspects you'll take on board. If you've observed certain things about a character, then you will get an understanding of what the vocal rhythms are, tendencies of that character are, and you can learn to play those, and you do practice to play those. Again, with those two characters I played, one of them had a very different vocal projection than the other. That was also a part of the development of the characters. But interestingly enough, and you probably know this as actors, as soon as you start to adopt a physicality, it does several things to you. One, it does affect your voice. You know, it does affect your strength as a character. All those things like status we talk about. It starts to affect you. And I know of actors that do this. They'll find their physicality first. Yeah. And it's so powerful. So powerful when it happens. And that physicality will... Actually, those two things are really important. Vocal and physicality are really important external aspects of it. The thought processes behind it must always be there. Must always be there. But... the physicalities and that truth is what enables us to, if you like, you and I had to sit down with our characters and improvise a 5-minute scene, we could do it because we have certain knowledge of how our characters behave in certain circumstances, even though we may not know, in this case, what they're thinking necessarily. We would know how they behave, and we would know what we think about each other, and we would have the best time for 5 minutes improvising something. Wouldn't we? It'd be such fun. Yeah, I'd like to do that. Sorry, sir, I said you could go next.
I was just wondering how drastically your process may or may not change from doing a film to a play.
Pretty drastically.
Yeah. More just technical
nuances,
like
a play. Oh, mate, yeah, absolutely. I don't know how many of you do theatre, but... as I said, I've just made a couple of comeback performances in New York in the last couple of years. And it surprised me how going back into that environment, again, where you actually do sit down, do table reads, and then you rehearse every day for hours and hours and hours and hours and hours. And I thought I'd hate it, but I didn't. I loved it. I actually loved it. And then, you know, you go into all of that, and then the slow runs through and the putting down of the scripts and... it all seems very different, and then into the tech rehearsals, which are endless, you know. And then finally the previews come along and everyone's nervous and vomiting, and that's all. Oh, nervous runs to the toilet, remember all that? Very different process. But it's different, or it's a different dynamic also, because in film and television we know that apart from the master shot that's going to be shot somewhere. They'll shoot a master somewhere, they might do a couple of two shots, but most of the time we're into singles, you know, particularly television. It's a very different thing from being, you know, the 5 or 6 of us on stage interacting and making this tableau work. It's a very different feeling, and I don't know. Look, the fundamentals of acting remain the same whatever you do, whether you're doing voice acting, whatever you're doing, it remains the same. but the technique of it is wildly different, actually. And film is also different from television. In film, you've got so much more time, which can be a benefit sometimes. I find it a bit boring. And also, they'll do more and more takes of things. And so you've got to be prepared for that, you know. But sometimes it also gives you a chance to develop those nuances that you may not get in the first 10 takes. And some directors will just let you go until such time as they find it. And that's fine. That's a beautiful thing, isn't it? It's a beautiful thing. And you know that there are technical requirements of, and that everything's shot out of sequence. You know all of that stuff. I mean, everything's shot out of sequence. Nothing is sequential in film and television at all. In fact, sometimes we're shooting several episodes at once, you know. So you need to have all that stuff in mind. But yeah, they are different, but the fundamental still remains. The fundamental still remains the same about being an actor, doesn't it? I think it does. I mean, I do a lot of voice work as well, and I treat that exactly the same. But technically, it's so different. You know, standing in a sound booth for 6 hours a day recording a crazy voice for a video game or something or other, you know? But it's the same game for me. It's the same degree of passion and same degree of fun, which we were talking about earlier, as the other stuff. But technically, it couldn't be more different. I actually did a great voice the other day. I got back in town and Channel 9 said, will you do the opening announcement for the game of Origin? What's it called? State of Origin, Wednesday night. So I did it, so you'll hear me Wednesday night. And I'm playing the turf of Suncor Stadium. I'm telling stories, go on. That happened today, just out of the blue.
Could you speak a little bit about your voice training that you did when you first started out? Yep. Today, still, like, caring for
a while. Does he put his cigarettes away? The voice training I did was very fortunate. I did a really old-fashioned classic RADA voice training. And there are four elements to it. Because it was for stage, essentially.
Yes.
So you learned diaphragmatic breathing, which gave you the power and the control to do what you needed to do. And from that diaphragmatic breathing, you learned the technique of projecting into big halls. And to do that, you also had to learn the power of articulation, because a lot of the time, if you don't articulate, you can't be heard back through the three. And then you had to learn the power of what effect body language has on the voice. In other words, how do you sing and dance at the same time, perhaps, if you like? How do you do that? And so there were the four elements that were put into us, and a whole lot of exercises. Now, I know that there's been many, many more different sophisticated voice systems since then. And, you know, I know about the Kristen Linkletters and all that. In fact, I know her well. I still don't understand her work, and I've told her so. You know, what's it all about, baby?
Who did you say?
Linkletter. Do you know her?
No.
Yeah. She's Scots, actually. I actually did a play with her son just recently. But it's fascinating to read, but I don't understand. Get your voice coming out of your bum or something. I tried to. No, that's what it is. Thank you, Ben. Because I used to teach voice and I thought I should know about all this. But I didn't understand it. I think I understand more than I'm letting on, but that was the really basic stuff. But here's the bonus of it. What I found by understanding the instrument, by learning to actually understand the instrument, all right? Then I learned how to do accents. Interesting, isn't it? That it's not just a matter of having this ear where some people can do it like a magical gift and some people magically can't do it. Mm-hmm. I think some of us do have a better musical ear and it is a musical ear we use for accents. But you actually to know where to place, how to articulate, what's the difference that's going on in here, because you understand your instrument, is hugely, hugely valuable for going into voice work. That's why I keep stressing to you. If you can get some voice training. Otherwise, I mean, you might get away with it, and film and television doesn't actually seem to require that of you. It doesn't even require articulation a lot of the time. Well, it doesn't. I mean, people... However, I think as a professional actor, you owe it to yourself to get that. If nothing else, get that part of your instrument tuned. Oh, I've been out of town for so long, mate. I wouldn't have a clue. There's bound to be some good ones around. I'd reckon the girls had it. There's a woman called Isabel Kirk who I knew years ago when we were kids. She was bloody good. I think she taught at night. I'm not sure where she is now. She was crazy, but she's a good voice teacher. Yes, sir. But I don't know. But check around. I mean, yeah, check around. Yeah.
So just on that, how much of that would you do? Like, I don't know if you do sort of the same amount, but back when you were sort of starting out, or whether you do the same amount, how much of your own personal kind of warm-up do you do each day?
For theatre or?
For both.
No, for film and television, virtually nil, except I do some. coffee. No, I do some. But really just to make sure that I've got a voice happening. For stage, I still do quite a substantial warm-up. Not as substantial as some, but I still do it. Same as I always did, which is going out and doing those exercises that I talked about with the exercises she gave me. And it's fun. Well, all the actors do it. Yes, sir.
You've done quite a bit of voice acting. Mm-hmm. Did you fall into that, or was it something you sought out?
Okay. I'm blessed with a certain type of voice, and there is an anecdote that I can share with you here too. So when I was, I think even before I started out maybe, a fellow, an advertising executive, heard my voice and he said, man, this is a great voice, we've got to use this. And I said, yeah, sure, mate, yeah, I'm in, yeah, use me. So he took me into a recording studio. And he said, all right, this is what we do. Well, I went into the recording studio and I put the cans on, I didn't know what was going on. And I tried to sound like a radio announcer. Because I thought that's what you had to do. Like a radio announcer. And they're looking at me thinking, what the hell is this boy doing? What the hell is he doing? This is the ABC News. And anyway, they kindly nodded at me and let me go. No, I was working as a professional by then. And I went to this Isabel Kirk, who was a very good voice. That's right. And I said to Isabel, what the hell do you do? And she said, oh, John. She said, just get in there and do it. She was crazy. Just get in and move your arms around us. Get stuck in. Let them worry about where the sound's coming from. And I suddenly realised I turned the lights on. So I go in there and I'm ripping into it and groaning and carrying on. Reason is that I'm releasing my body, you see. See how my body's being released by all of that? Instead of being a radio announcer here, which is such crap. And after a while you can get the semblance of all of that without jumping around. But that was a true story of Isabel Kirk. Crazy lady. I love it. Yeah.
Sarah, you had a question?
We're obviously all human. So how do you take, like, when you get sick? Sorry.
We are human.
Okay, Sarah. Yes, okay.
Yes, yeah, good point.
We'll accept that at this point.
Yeah, good point. Point
all right,
taken.
Darling, yeah.
When you get sick or, like, you have any personal issues and obviously mm-hmm. and that sort of stuff, how do you deal with that so that you're on, like, obviously I find it, you know, when you have a really bad day, it's really hard to mask it.
Let me be really hard. Can I be really hard about this?
No. Okay.
No, really hard. Let me be really hard. All of us get sick, yes. Mm-hmm. All of us will still go to work unless we're really, really sick. Mm-hmm. That's what we do. All of us would then let the AD know that we're off colour. We will do that too. But all of us will also then go out and do the job we're paid to do. That's what I'm talking about here. That's on sickness. And you know, there's many of us that have gone off and vomited in corners, I can tell you now. Seriously. But that's what we do, okay? You can't, unless you're really ill, you can't pull the plug on something because you'll have 200 people left waiting for you. So think about that. And sometimes it's so hard. So hard. With your own personal thing is another matter. And this is also really, really hard. I've always believed that your ego has no place whatsoever on the stage with you at all. At all. Your concerns, I use the word ego, I think we know what it means. Your opinions about things, what you think of other people, has no place whatsoever on the stage. So what I say to all of us and to myself is, take that ego and leave it parked outside the stage door. It'll still be there for you when you come out. Leave it there, because otherwise you screw it for everyone. And I've worked with too many actors that bring their egos onto stage and they're unbearable. Unbloody bearable. I actually have a couple in mind. They make life unbearable for people by carrying their own griefs and grievances onto where they're supposed to be professionals doing a job. Oh, that's pretty harsh, isn't it? But that's what I believe from the bottom of my heart. Leave it outside. You can, you know, you can do it. And it's so unfair to not do it. To not do it. Yes. Yes, sir.
Yeah. When performing, when you're working, your characters you're playing, do you play the job they're doing or the person they are doing that job? If you're a policeman, do you play a policeman? Or do you play John Noble, who also happens to be a policeman?
No, I never played John Noble.
I mean, well.
No. I'm trying to work out what you... Do you know, I don't... it's an interesting question. I try not to play labels, okay? Sometimes people will say to me, what's it like playing bad guys? And I have to balk at that and say, well, I don't actually play bad guys. They may, in the greater scheme of things, behave in such a way that's perceived to be bad. But I don't go out to play bad guys. I go out to play human beings. Human beings who believe that they're doing the very best they can in that given moment. Huh? That they're making the right choices for themselves in that very moment. Not bad guys.
Why did you have to burn his son?
Because I thought it was the right thing at the time. Okay. No, I never play that. And so if you start to play around with these really, really, really complex characters, which I have had the great fortune of having done, I play through their twisted morass of whatever's happening in their mind. I play what they believe to be the correct decision at the time, even though some of them are awful. And some of them are really unusual, but I actually understand every one of them. Every one. I never ever play anything I don't understand. Or do a line I don't understand. Which is another point for you guys. If you're doing stuff and you don't actually have a meaning for what you're doing, even if it's a lot of difficult language, for example, and you don't know what it means, make something up in your head. Doesn't matter what it is. Make it up. Because if you don't, and you just say the word, it'll show in your eyes, and you'll be lying, and then you're deadly. Make it up. Does that answer your question, sir? Not quite. Certainly it's not me.
No, what I mean was, if you were to play a teacher, would you play the personification of teacherism, teacheristic?
The mannerisms?
Or mannerisms, or the... Okay. So you look at that guy and you think, oh man, in a room full of teachers, all the teachers would point that guy and say, doesn't that guy look like a teacher?
Well,
or do you play a person, a human being, who has a job as a teacher?
I think I've got you an answer for you. What I've already said to us is that we will find out the mannerisms of a character as part of our first research. And a teacher will have certain mannerisms and certain required mannerisms. So I will play those. If that then makes me appear to be a teacher, then so be it. But I don't want to go out and play a stereotype teacher. if a teacher has a certain vocal pattern, then I've studied that and made that part of my character. Yeah, I will be. But it's the other way around, rather than me trying to do a stereotype. Stereotypes are... And they're so embarrassing to play, too.
Well, also, I've been told that I don't talk like a welder, mm-hmm. even though that's what I do for a living.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I don't know what I sound like, but people expect...
They expect you to sound like a knocker, mate.
Yeah, in a particular way. But, yeah, I don't know.
It's but it's generalisations, just generalisations. I'm glad you don't sound that way. Do you know what I mean? But if you had to play some... Someone said, I want a real like a welder now, you know? Uh-huh. You could probably do it.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, you could do it easily if you had to, but you don't have to be that yourself. Uh-huh. I mean, I can still play as broad as anything if I want to. Really, I mean, really vile broad. And it's such fun to do it sometimes. I'm just a country boy, remember? But, no, you are not that person, sir. And you will then don the clothing of that character. And leave your own outside. Yeah. Thank you. Yep. Thank you for repeating the question. What? Yes, set. Ma'am.
I'm just curious. Have other actors in your experience in the past ever done something, whether it be in rehearsal or on stage or on TV or in film, that's made you better without expecting it? And if so, what did they do?
Oh, yeah. No, it's a beautiful question. On the rare occasions, those beautiful occasions where you are working a scene with someone and they are so fucking wonderful, sorry to swear, but so fucking wonderful, and they're so tightly there and they're so committed and they're so engaged with you that you can't do anything else but lift with them. And that's happened to me on occasions. Doesn't happen as much as you'd hope, you know. But when it does, oh my Lord, you wouldn't be anywhere else in the world when you find that happen sometimes. And it might only be with any number of actors, it may not happen all the time, but just maybe in one scene there's something happens and you find this connection and the rest of the world disappears around you and you're just into each other's sensations, into each other's faces, into each other's emotions, and the world stands still. You know that feeling yet? My God. It's one of the reasons I keep acting, is for that. I think it's a feeling that we all, in any of the arts that we practice, that's the feeling we go for, is that magical, euphoric feeling. Then I often look at, say, a concert pianist playing, and they go into a place, don't they, for all of the millions of hours I've spent practicing, once they're into this piece, they go somewhere. They disappear. They disappear. And they go somewhere. Their hands are doing things which hands shouldn't be able to do. And they're there. And I'm looking at them going, where the hell are you? They're in another place. And if they lose that concentration, they lose it. You know. You watch a painter work. You watch a painter work. This painter, she will be in here. And she will be totally, totally fixated on something, and will not become unfixated until she steps back here to do as painters do. To go, do you know that? How people step back from stuff? Writers do it all the time. Write. Don't try and write and edit at the same time. Write. And then, at some certain date, you step back and edit. It's a different part of the brain. But it's when you're in that space, I put such a smile on my face. But it's that's why I do it. So Ainsley's. Yes, I have been lifted by other people, absolutely.
Ainsley.
Yeah.
It's just a question in preparation. So obviously, you know, you can prep like to the end of time. But have you found a sweet spot where you feel? Because that's the age, like that's one of my biggest fears is I haven't done enough for it to get lost in it on the day. So if you just do, you just feel that out as you're prepping.
Yeah, it's so hard to answer that one. No, it is really hard to answer that one. You can over-prepare. You really can. And you can tie yourself up in knots. And sometimes you'll feel that you have prepared enough and you'll get a surprise interaction from someone else and you go, oh shit, I wasn't ready for that. I wish there was a glib... But if the over-preparation is coming from a sort of neuroses, which it often does, that's when we can be careful. You know, if the sane you says, oh my God, I'm all over this, and then the neurotic you says, no, you're not, get back in there again. Which it does sometimes. Oh, I'm going to go back in again, wake up 3 o'clock in the morning. No, I've got to get out. Which we've all done, I think. It's when the neuroses set in, maybe. But do the work. Do the work we've talked about here today, which gives you such security, doesn't it? It's just, you're just so secure when you've done that. And you know, I talk about, sometimes talking about in the moment stuff, I just recorded something. You may have a certain amount of preparation done. And I can remember being in a car going to set some moment, some days, just sort of being driven somewhere. Oh my God. And I'll have this insight into a reading of the line. I mean, it's like that. It's bizarre. It might be ridiculous. But I love it. And I do it every time. But it's like, it's come, bingo. And suddenly you get this bizarre thing happening. But it's I'm already ready anyway. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Just say when you have one of those insights and you're not in your acting arena or so forth, you might be driving.
Yep, sure.
Do you then, like when you get out of the car or wherever you are, would you then want to try and embody it? Or would you just wait till you go back to it later? Or?
I don't know. I don't think there's an easy answer to that. I think if it strikes you that way, you're not going to forget it, to be honest. So it sort of sits there. Well, you can get caught in strange positions, and this is a sort of a bit of a non sequitur. Something happened recently. I was doing a voiceover for the American show American Dad, and they're always incredibly funny stuff. So I'm walking down the streets of New York, and I'm thinking, oh, I'll give them two voices. I'll give them two options. And I'm just thinking, as I'm going, I know it'll be okay. And I didn't realise I was doing them both out loud. I mean, lots of people talk to themselves in New York, believe me. But I was going along, give me two versions of this particular voice. And this girl in front of me turned around and looked at me like I was the strange. What? Oh, fuck. I'm doing these voices. I kind of didn't mind. I was just sort of playing around, just having fun. Except the only way to tell if we're sane or not is if you've got earbuds in New York, and I didn't. I didn't have them in. I wasn't on the phone. Don't know why I told you that story. Yes, sir. Which one of you, sir?
I've got a question for you.
Please do. I gathered that.
Some advice.
Mm-hmm. Question?
Yeah, question. Advice.
Okay. Advice.
So, you're on set, okay, like as a young guy, not much experience. Mm-hmm. There you go. Now, when it's like your moment and they're about to call action, they're setting up the cameras, sorting out the lights, blah, 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 and you've got your moment and you're about to be on and it's big, big moment. What do you like, what would your advice to be to like hook into? Like what, do you moment before you're just about to come on? Because I think it can be easy to like, get lost, or maybe fear comes in, or you start thinking about yourself too much. But what advice could you give that the next time I'm in that moment and I hear this little voice of John Noble saying,
No, look, there's a series of different things. There's a series of different things, and sometimes they're really hard. Sometimes you don't. Other people aren't aware of what you're going through, and I've seen many situations where. For example, if you're on as a guest actor and regular cast members who aren't having to concentrate, so it will keep on talking, or camera people will keep talking among themselves right up until the final moment, that's really hard, really hard. You do need to do this. Stop talking to people. Don't talk to people. Just go into a place. An alert place, but go into a place. Huh? Don't talk to people. Don't listen to what they're saying either, except, you know, you'll hear the sounds of the action. Stay there in that place. No one notices what you're doing. Just stay there. don't be looking around saying we're nearly ready, whatever. You see what I'm doing? I'm pulling myself out, aren't I? I'm getting excited. I'm going to do this. No, no, no. Stay still. I do this, and it's very strange. I just sort of go into a tree pose. Quite often. For no reason whatsoever. Except I do know why. Because I have to concentrate. For example. Not saying that that's great acting advice, but it's just something to... And I have been known on occasions. I don't ever scream and yell on set or complain, but there have been occasions when I have been confronted with that other issue of the chatter going on, and I just walk away. I wouldn't advise that when you're first starting off, but just walk away. Don't say, oh, shut the fuck up. No, no, no. I just walk. And then there's suddenly what's happened. Then I'll come back in again. And if it keeps going, I'll walk away again. You don't actually have to do it too many times at the company. But do you see what the effect of that is? But you do owe it to yourself to get that moment if you can. And sometimes I am embarrassed by other lead actors that don't remember that. We always try to make guest actors feel very welcome on shows I'm on, but it doesn't happen everywhere. Yep.
Matt, have you ever come across when playing opposite actors where they're not on their A game? You know, sometimes for me, someone that opposite me is on their A game, it kind of inspires me to,
lift you. Shouldn't. No, no. I don't think it does.
Or would you, is there a way, would you actually want
that? Look, the only thing that I would feel would be incredible compassion. I would feel incredible compassion because I would know what crap they were going through and would do everything in my power to make it easier without sacrificing my own work. But I certainly wouldn't create a tantrum or anything because they were losing it. I'd be very inclined and do this sometimes if a person's finding it hard. I'll actually go and sit with them and talk with them. But not everyone does that. It's quite unusual. And sometimes I've been known to go and say to people, do you want to do a line run? Again, very unusual. That's just because I'm an actor and they're actors and they're having a bad day, you know what I mean? No, I don't feel bad about it. And I don't let it affect my performance because my performance is almost always independent of them anyway, because the key performances in film and television aren't those face-to-face 50-50s. They are this one here, and you can really live without them if you want to. You really don't even need them there, to be honest with you, sometimes. And sometimes you're playing into the corner of the mat box and you literally can't see them. So, but no, just always compassion, mate. It breaks my heart when I see it happening. Yeah. Yes.
Do you know how you were saying before, sometimes you'll get the script on the day?
Mm-hmm.
In film and TV, actually both will make a difference. Will you, you'll obviously get a big brief of the character and you go into that and then the scenes happen on the day, so you know the character so well. So the prepping thing, does it become a problem? Does it become a problem? Because you know how we were talking about before, you can over-prep. How do you? You can't really
over-prep
when you get the scene on the day.
Well, you can. You can stay up all night. You're prepping your character. There's a difference. We got. I think we need to draw the distinction between ongoing characters, which in a sense are much easier to play, than guests. Yeah. Guest actors are so hard to play, even if the major guests on a show. They're so hard to play because you're coming in as the new kid on the block. And everyone else is already in their stride. And in good companies, you'll be made to feel very comfortable, but not all companies are good companies to guest actors, to be honest with you. I remember once going, I was in Los Angeles, and I got offered this guest role, quite a good guest role on a show called The Unit, years ago now. Anyway, so I had to drive to the set, and I got out to the set, all the trailers, and I hopped out, and the fourth AD or something was there, and I said, oh, g'day, mate, I'm John Noble. He said, yeah, well, the extra's tent's down there. I said, no, I'm in it. He said, yeah, mate, the extra's tent's down there. I said, but I'm not an extra. Well, what do they call them, background?
Background.
Yeah, background. Yeah. And I said, but I'm not a background. Oh, yeah. Well, what are you doing? Oh, yeah, right, mate, come this way. That was so shattering. I looked like the background player. And it actually didn't improve much on that show either. They weren't the friendliest people. Oh, a couple of them were lovely. And the director was a prick. I took his name too.
Yeah, right, never worked with him.
I haven't.
I want to change the, because we're starting to run out of time a little bit.
Tone.
To look at auditioning.
Yep.
Going into auditions and the beast that is auditioning.
Yep.
Do you have anything that you do when you're kind of sitting in that room and all of a sudden you kind of call and then that person goes in, you're next, and all of a sudden you feel that kind of anxiety, you feel, and you start to
yes,
forget your lines in before you got in?
My talk to my friend here holds firm. So, you know, you do go, and it's a horrible situation, isn't it? You're getting bloody cattle calls, or, you know, there's a lot of people going, so you walk in the room, you see all these other actors, and you're like, oh, shit, they're better than me. Well, I don't do that anymore. Seriously. I mean, I do go into prepared. I go and I sit very quietly. Just sit very quietly. Maybe nod at people. If people start to talk to me, I just nod, but I don't talk back because I don't want to. I don't want to chatter to people. And I don't care if people like me or not, to be honest with you, at that point. And I just stay there, and then at some point they'll, you know, then a gushing, carting person, oh, John, a wonderful within a minute. I don't care. Do you know that gush they get? So I don't try. And then to enter the room, this is really important. When you enter the room, there is a tendency of us, particularly if there's a bank of people there, sometimes there are, but certainly there's going to be a casting director, maybe a reader and something there. Sometimes you get a whole bank of them sitting across there, producers, and there's this tendency of thinking, oh my God, I hope they like me. You know that one? I hope they like me. And so we want them to like us. We go into our nicest person thing. And it's nothing to do with why we're there. Nothing to do with it. So again, I would suggest this to you, that you hold that we talked about there. You don't be surly or anything. You'll know where the mark is. They'll tell you what you want, where they want you to be. They will say to you almost always, do you have any questions? Don't if you do say so. If you don't. You know what I think? Well, no, I don't think so. But how often do we do that? No. but if you do have one, ask it. If you think it's really critical. But if it's just, oh, yeah, well, I was wondering, you know, if I played it that way, no, do it. Give the performance. Do it really beautifully. If they want an adjustment on that, they will ask you for it. Do you know what I mean? If you've done that well, your interpretation has been done well, they'll say, that was bloody good. Could you change that rhythm on that second speak? Can you do that? And you say, of course I can, because I'm prepared. You know, I'm prepared. Of course I can. And you go, boom, and you do that again. And you're so in control of that environment. And there's such mutual respect running between you. And that's the strength, for me, sir, of the audition process. Does that make sense to you? And those other pitfalls that we fall into, which is so human, and then we walk out and think, oh, they thought I was crap. And then we don't get the job and we think you're a failure. Ooh, did I do that? It wasn't me. That's another. So I just want to finish this point, that the walk away from an audition where you sit and wait and you think, I have failed, they didn't like me. Do you know that one? That is almost never true. And you didn't fail. Chances are that there are probably at least a dozen reasons why you were not chosen, given that you've given your best shot, by the way. If you haven't given your best shot, forget it. Another dozen reasons that you didn't get chosen. But here's a really important thing. If you've given a good audition, the chances are, and this happens more often than you can think, that they'll remember you and bring you back in for something else, or even cast you straight off as something else. How many stories have you heard? Yeah. It's happened to me twice. One good audition, didn't get it, but they say, but that was better, and you come back and get a better role without even having to audition for it. So remember that. Sorry. Yes, love.
I was just thinking on the topic of the thoughts around failure and all these things that we go through.
Yeah.
What do you
meditate and tree pose? Do you do yoga? Like what?
I do actually.
Well,
I haven't always been sane. Let me say that. No, I mean, I went through some awful anxieties at different times of my life, which probably makes me well qualified to talk about this topic. Yeah, I do actually do yoga.
Yeah.
I try not to linger at all in the past, the victories or the failures, by the way. Both are equally destructive to me. I try not to go into the future too much because actually I can't control it. I just have no control. I don't have any control. So it's just, and I've also been guilty of doing this, by the way. This is all experience. So I stay within the moment, but I'm really concerned to practice my craft. It's a matter of personal pride for me to practice my craft at that moment I go in there. That's what I love to do. If it's not now, I've reached a stage. If it's not what they want, that's fine. Because I don't ever feel like I'm crap or that I've failed. And that's been a learning process. And I can tell you now, no one ever told me this when we were coming through. We had nothing like this of people talking to us as actors. It was amazing. So projection is a deadly thing, and it's almost impossible not to do it. But if you can, find yourself something else to do. You know, we're dangerous animals because we're so passionate about what we do, and what we want to do is to be creative. That's what we want, and we put ourselves in a situation for a large part of the time we can't be creative in that. If we wait for other people to give us permission, I actually have to put that, if we wait for other people, i.e. employers, then we're going to be disappointed a lot of the time. However, if we do what we were talking about earlier, of getting together a group of people, that's a different story. Then you're totally creative at all times. And you'll find it'll explore and it'll expand into other aspects of your life too, that whatever you do will become creative because you're on fire. And I'm not only talking about playing piano or painting, I'm talking about everything you do will become creative. You'll have that. You know that feeling when you just, you know, it's like you've had 10 Adderall and you're feeling great. Yeah, see you soon.
Yeah, you sound like someone who has a lot of creative, I don't know, power over what it is they do when they work.
Yep.
I sometimes have this existential crisis where I'm not really sure how creative I'm being, in the sense that someone said to me once, the actors seems more like a paintbrush than the actual, like, artists themselves. And is that you're working with crappy people if you don't feel like you're ever into creatively move about and experiment throughout working? Or is that, I don't know, just sort of the way it goes? I say that because, well, does it come with experience? Like, as you move on, you're just given more room to see it as your creative endeavor instead of just following directions?
No. And what you're experiencing is very natural. It's a very natural process. No, and listen, guys, you know, one of the traps we can fall into and often do is to blame the things around us, you know. To blame this industry is daft, these casting people are wankers, these actors can't act, these directors, we get into this. And it, if it worked, I'd say go for it. Seriously, if I thought it helped, I'd say go for it, rip into them. But it doesn't. It doesn't help you at all. So you go inside and you say, well, what is this creativity? What is this thing? Do I need to have anyone else's approval? Do I have anyone else's permission to be creative? The answer is no. It's a similar thing we were just talking about here. No, you don't. You don't need anyone's permission. And it's not going to be impinged by bad influences around you, like bad actors. No, that you won't be impinged by them. You really won't. You may have to work a little harder. You may have to put into place other techniques. But you won't be stopped, and it's a terrible thing if you allow yourself to be brought down by other people's mediocrity. Okay? Don't be brought down by other people's mediocrity, if you possibly can, because it'll break your heart. It will break your spirit if you do that. Don't do it.
Beck, you got a question?
I have a juxtaposed question. Did you ever have a sense of fear and failure when you were starting out in your career?
how do you get a hold of that or handle that going through your career, and do you still have a sense of fear of failure now?
Yeah, I have had them. Oh, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. These anecdotes I'm telling you are not some God-given wisdom. These are things that I've had to learn through failure a lot of the time. There's an anecdote I often tell about... I was so down on myself at one stage, and I was desperate for work, and I was going for auditions, and I was getting nothing. And I was desperate, and I was going in there, and I fucking wanted these jobs, and I was going in like this. And I'd do nothing. And I rang my agent and I said, I've finished. I'm done. I'm out of here. I can't do this anymore. I'm serious. I'm finished. She said, oh, okay. I suppose the agents have heard it so many times. She rang me 2 weeks later and she said, John, so-and-so wants you to audition for this role he's got. This director. And I said, hell no, no, I've told you. No. I'm not going to. I've got something else I'm doing that day. And she said, no, it's all right. Come, look, you'll see you at 7:30 in the morning, whatever. And then something twitched. And I said, oh, all right. Here's the difference. That moment, I remembered why I act. I didn't want the job. I didn't need the fucking job. I didn't want it. But I remembered why I acted. And then I got the script, which actually was a beautiful thing. And I could feel myself opening up like a flower as I read this piece, and I started to go into the process of doing what I do. And the long story short is, as you would hope, I got that job and really never looked back. What's the key, though? The key principle there is when I wanted it so badly that I was like this and full of tension and anxiety, I didn't get it because I wasn't being truthful to my craft. When I was able to let that go by letting it go, then it turned around and really turned around big time. I mean, big time for me. It's a true story. The what?
To overcome, I guess not just saying to overcome the fear of to get a hold of the fear, it's just to allow yourself to fail. And then from there, find the love of what you do again.
Well, I don't know. Did I allow myself to fail? I was so desperate. And so hurting so badly because I had known that I was a good actor, but then I wasn't getting a sniff at just ordinary stuff because I was too desperate. Now, I'll expand on that for a sec. I worked many years as a director, and people would come in to see you. And if they were coming in trying too hard, then I would start to get anxious for them. And if they're giving nervous performance, I'd be anxious for them, but I didn't employ them. Because they made me feel uncomfortable. If I had to go into a work environment with someone that was going to make me feel uncomfortable, I didn't want to. So that's kind of interesting, isn't it? Yeah. Both sides of it there. Yes, sir.
Yeah, I just wanted to ask... how much of your opinion, maybe just as far as maybe as life experience in general, just experience as an actor, has had an effect on the type of stories that you chose?
To like perform in.
The type of stories that you like that you chose.
To tell or to act in. To tell or act in. I'm sorry, the stories
we'll
I tell.
Say as far as like the stories.
Itself. The stories I tell. The stories I tell myself, John Noble, are all based on truth. Absolutely. But you're talking about what roles do I do? Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, look, to some extent, I guess people offer me certain types of roles because they know I can do it, and they wouldn't offer me other sorts of roles. That makes it kind of easy. I have turned down some roles. But as a working actor when I was young, I didn't. No, did everything. Anything they offered me, I did it. Oh, thank God, yeah, I'll take it. Some awful stuff.
We've all done that.
No. Yeah. And it pops up every now and again.
That's the word. I thought this was dead.
Oh, jeez, I was at a place, I was up in someplace in America at a fan conference recently, and a fan came up with this little bundle of DVDs. And she said, "Oh, look, I've got these views." I'm like, "Oh, fuck."
I'm not starting.
Oh, it's just truly embarrassing things. I can feel myself blushing now. But she'd found them all because she thought they were all beaut because I was in them.
Beck.
No, bless her heart. Oh, she's not blushing. I haven't looked at them yet. They're sitting on my desk like a reminder. Humility, humility, humility. Yeah, no.
Beck.
Of a two-pronged question. Given that you and Tom are both expats, I'm interested for your perspective of the local industry here in Australia and the future of that. I'm not asking you to forecast it, but just interested on your insights. And secondly, I guess in this day and age, the new ways of accessing content and access to audiences and how that's impacted, you know, what your experiences have been.
Okay, well, that's a huge question, actually. It's a many, many pronged question. No. It's a very important question. I've been out of the industry here for too long. I did come back a few years ago for 6 months, and I had the time of my life. I worked all the time I was here, but I don't think that's normal, do you know? It's always been hard. Australia's always been hard. And it's also doubly hard because we as actors are not given any credibility in this country. We continually have to apologise for ourselves as if we're sort of some strange alien beasts. You know, that in itself I think has an advantage for us when we go overseas, because we certainly don't go over with any inflated egos. We come with a very, very great sense of gratitude about what we do, and that's our reputation overseas. And Australians are fantastic. Nearly all. There's two exceptions, I hate to tell you. I'm so disappointed when I hear about an Australian actor as being an AL. I get so hurt. How could that be? And I heard it too recently. I just want to give him a good telling off. No.
We won't.
That would be gossiping. Yeah, yeah. And we don't gossip about fellow Aussies. It was always been tough. And that's not going to change. However, you also live in a very fortunate time. One, we live in an age of worldwide casting. So you don't have to go and sit around in Melrose over in Los Angeles for 9 months now anymore to, you know, as much as it's great fun to do it when you're young. They'll cast, you know, you've got casters here casting for American shows all the time, for example, or British shows. Harder to get into Britain because there's so many bloody actors there who are so superb. So that's an advantage for us. But the second part of it is, and also to be ready for these auditions when they come. And if that means making sure you've got your bloody standard American down, well, get it down. Just get it down. Don't wait for a week beforehand. Get it down. It's easy for us Australians. We're really, really good at it. We're great at accents. The second part is the new media. And this is where it's exciting, because now there are so many people creating their own content. The internet is, there is no world. It's all just click, click. So you can create your own stuff. And it's really powerful. It's really powerful. And stuff is then being picked up by other channels and going, gee, if we want this, that's happening more and more. And people are doing little pieces, you know, which become sort of wonderfully known around the world. And gets you seen and pulls out your producer skills, so you are no longer, back to creativity, you are no longer waiting for someone's permission to be creative. And it costs you nothing. Eh? It costs you nothing. You can make them in your living room. So don't actually think you have to sit around and wait anymore. For the first time in history, you don't have to sit around and wait anymore. Isn't that bloody exciting? So you live in a very fortunate time. Keep an eye on all of that web content, because some of it is really good and really creative, and stuff that will not get through the hoops that you've had to go through to get your stuff produced in Hollywood doesn't have to go through those hoops. It goes straight to the audience, and then the ultimate judge will tell how it goes. And if it's really good, you can start to make some money out of it too. An exciting time to take risks, to not be powerless. Don't sit around in coffee lounges and whinge at each other. No, and I mean that most seriously. I've seen Los Angeles destroy young actors and you know, yeah. I have. Just destroy them. Wonderful, wonderful young actors who have been brought to mediocre nothings by that system. Particularly young girls. What? They are, because they're led to believe that everyone should be the new something instead of the first something else. All of the girls are told to look in a certain way. They're told to get their boobs done in a certain way and their lips pouted, and they finish up looking like nobody. They don't look like anybody. And then they all are told that there's a certain way to audition and there's a certain way not to over-prepare, and all of this bullshit you hear around the place. Don't over-prepare. They think it's your best shot. You've got to be kidding. Of course you prepare. You don't go in there and say, oh, well, I can do better than this. But I've heard that said over there.
Yeah.
I couldn't believe it. Rubbish. And then they sit around on Melrose loving each other, loving, 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 till they find out their best friend got an audition. Then they're on the phone to their agent. So-and-so just got an audition. And look at the tension. This happens all over the place. It's vicious. And I've seen it destroy some wonderful people. And it happens here too in Darlinghurst.
John, when we were training, I remember we were all sitting there. It was myself, Marty, Andy, and you know, a whole bunch of other great actors. Sammy, yeah, Benny Hanley as well, all of us. And we were sitting there going, what's the next thing? We didn't have cameras on our phones. We just couldn't do this shit. And we were talking to John, and John just goes, do shit. Come to my lounge room. Let's do stuff. And we just used to go to John's house, and John would facilitate it. And every week we just turned up at John's with tea and coffee and we'd just do shit. And then John started booking stuff and would leave. And we're like, well, do we want to keep doing stuff? He's sparked it. And we just kept, for years, we just kept this little group of us, right? We just meet.
And so many of you went on to work very well professionally. But it was risk taking. Oh, sorry, keep pointing back there. It was risk. And we created a totally safe environment. Yeah. Criticism was not acceptable. I actually had to remove one man. Which is hard. I actually like this man. But he couldn't resist becoming competitive. He couldn't resist it. And so the safe environment was challenged. And I had to say to him, sorry, mate, this is not for you. But the rest of them, and I can remember people doing astonishing things, coming in doing stuff they had no right to do. No right to do whatsoever. But of course they had the right, but they didn't think they did. I remember your wife so clearly one day, the beautiful Marty. And she walked into this incredible place with a guitar, and she'd been learning the guitar about a week or something. And she said, oh, I hope you don't mind, but I've just started to learn the guitar and I've got a song I've made up. It was so beautiful. It was so fucking beautiful, man. Do you remember?
Yeah, I remember that.
I had tears rolling over. But the risk involved in that was astonishing. We had another bloke. We called him the beautiful. He was a Belgian man.
Ollie.
And Ollie was, you know. But then one day he came in and said, I want to show you something different. And he pulled out a painting that he'd done. We didn't know he painted. Neither did he. But he went on to become a professional painter. Because he found within that environment the ability to risk and to totally trust these guys that they would support. That's what you need to find. And that's what works. That's where the great work comes from, by the way. Always. Always comes from there. Not from bad behaviour.
So that's bringing us to the end of our session. Time flies when you're having fun. Is there some last thoughts or ideas? Like, everyone in this room is like some of the most gorgeous, talented, loving people I've ever met in my life. And that's why Marty and I really wanted to get these gorgeous people to meet the gorgeous person. And so what can you kind of leave with all of us? It can be anything, just anything.
Listen, the very fact that you're sitting in this room now says, and that nobody in this room has said to me, well, how do I get an agent? Or any of the tacky questions that I'm sometimes given. Yeah, well, how do you get a visa? Because I sometimes, that would be a waste of time asking me that. There are many people you could ask that, and I thank you for not going there. That indicates a lot to me. And you've also asked some very brave questions. Some very brave questions about your fears and your inhibitions and tough stuff, you know. kind of makes it really worthwhile. And I've answered you absolutely honestly from my own experience. These are true, you know, absolutely true stories. So that's been a lovely year. You've been taking the risk to ask me the questions, and I've taken the risk to tell you. That's been kind of special for me too. So thank you very much for being here with me today.
Thank you.
Thank you.